All right. Awesome. Well, thanks everyone for coming to, I guess, is this our fifth Spark Accelerator program meeting? I think it is. So, well, today's topic is really about promoting our events and our experiences that we've come up with. And we have our special guest, Colin, which everyone probably remembers possibly from our last one. So thanks, Colin, for joining us. We're really excited to have you here. So I'm going to go ahead and just share my screen and just talk a little bit. Okay, I'm going to let other people in too. There's Gina. Hi, Gina.
Hi.
Welcome.
Oops, there we go.
Awesome. Oh, you got my favorite shirt on.
I do.
That's Gina's good cop, bad cop shirt.
I'll be nice right now.
Yeah.
Is that the clothing equivalent of the mullet? It's like party on the left and business on the right.
That's right. And I brought my party table, one of them.
Oh my gosh, look at that. Oh my gosh, show it to us again. I want to see that thing.
And our team, Julie on our team, we were brainstorming the other day because this is the small one, and it's we're gonna have like different sets of questions for different meeting groups, but then we came up with an even better idea. Big vinyl thing that we're going to put on the floor, and you have to walk into the areas, and you'll meet in the middle to negotiate. And like, we came up with so many great ideas that came from the table. So yeah, really fun.
That's cool. Well, I can't wait to come down and experience.
I know. I'm super excited about that. I'm going today to buy the vinyl for it.
Cool. Well, welcome, Bridget. Thanks for joining. Oh, she's connecting. This is Bridget's last day at the aquarium. So as you can see in the background there, she has all the fish.
Yes, it's very exciting, and I'm in my Wild Dreams Overnight shirt. So if anyone wants to come by for free, I'll be here.
Last day at the aquarium, where are you going?
Nowhere. I just couldn't keep doing the full time because the school year is about to start. So, and I've been picking up with my business. So
that's
just
good.
Doing that and kind of transitioning to as needed projects here and there. So yeah.
Very cool.
I always kind of thought it was funny that they have a fish restaurant.
That is kind of funny.
Owned by Landry's. So I've always been a little questionable, but I mean, there is a great education department here, which is what I'm part of. So it is fun.
That's awesome. Yeah. We'll all have to take a little group trip, I guess, to the aquarium. So you can give us a scoop to it.
I could probably sneak a group tour in for everyone. That would be pretty fun.
That's awesome. Well, and welcome, Dawn. Thanks for joining us. All right, so I will go ahead and share my screen here, and I won't talk too long, but all right, everyone can see that? Yep. All right, so since we now all have our projects figured out and funded, I thought it would be good just to kind of bring this up to talk about really just like building buzz and kind of thinking about the different points along your project's really kind of story arc to think about how you build buzz. And we have Colin here to really kind of do a deeper dive into this, but I thought it was just kind of worth sharing, just kind of thinking about at every point of your project's timeline as it relates to the story arc is an opportunity for building community engagement and also just like telling your story. And so I'll send this to everyone so you can kind of have it to kind of think about like how your project would fit into this. But I'll just go ahead and kind of turn it over to Colin now and really have him start kind of thinking about what are the ins and outs of really kind of, again, enlisting other people and your customers and your supporters and your champions into helping really kind of communicate your story to more people. So I will go ahead and stop sharing here and turn it over to Colin.
Cool. Hey, well, thank you for having me. It was really great hearing all of your ideas a couple of weeks back. So I hope a few of my ideas prove helpful. So yeah, I kind of wanted to talk about creating your own narrative and also enlisting others to help you tell your story. And basically what I want to go over today is why good storytelling matters, the difference between writing and storytelling, telling your own story versus telling your business's story, versus using storytelling to help others inhabit the experience. And then kind of getting into the kind of media end of things and using others to help your story. And I'll go over kind of dealing with PR and PR firms. And then probably something that I have the most experience on is dealing with journalists. So yeah, let's start with why good storytelling matters, how to sort of develop your business ideas into something that you can share with people and that people will respond to and get excited about. So first of all, plain and simple, stories give things life. It arranges all the information that you have into something tangible and something that people can take interest in. And going from there, things are way more attractive when they're communicated in an inspiring way. So sort of ideas can be loose, and the more you can kind of tighten them into something clear, the better people will respond. And it's a good way to focus your ideas. And even more than that, when you're writing your story, when you're developing sort of a clear vision for what you have going on, it can help you develop new ideas. And once your story is told for people who are reading it, it can help to develop expectations, you know? So when people are coming in and trying to enjoy whatever experience you're bringing to the table, it can usually work as a springboard or a baseline for people to start to develop their own narratives. So whatever ideas you have, they can sort of expand from that. People enjoy things more when they have some background. Think like wine appreciation, you know, if people know a thing or two about it, they can sort of indulge in it a little more. Or like movies with historical context. The more you give people up front, the more they're going to be able to take away. And especially if money is on the table, people are mostly going to buy or invest in things where details are communicated as clearly as possible. And so from there, the differences between writing and storytelling, everybody can write. And it took me a long time to sort of move from writing into storytelling. And storytelling involves taking all the valuable information and finding some kind of narrative cohesion. And sort of that involves, and sometimes stories can write themselves in kind of a way you can kind of discover the story as you're going through stuff. And if anybody has any questions, you can chime in. And other times you have to, or you can, and you have the opportunity to build a narrative that better suits your interests or highlights certain aspects of whatever you're trying to present. So basically you can tell the story as it kind of comes to you, or you can make a story that kind of fits the vision or fits what it is that you're trying to get across, or whatever you're trying to highlight. Whatever you think is most important, you can build your story around that. And so when you're trying to when you're trying to create a story for your business, there's like several ways to do it. And usually I feel the best way to kind of communicate a story to media or to customers is if you do a combination of telling your own story, telling your business's story, and then telling some kind of narrative that gives people an idea of what they're getting into. So when you're telling your own story, it's not necessarily necessary to tell your own story, it's just a good opportunity. Sometimes a certain amount of biographical information can help lend texture to whatever you're trying to sell. You know, like giving a little background on yourself can make people more interested at the outset. And so it's good to be open, especially with details about what led you to the, specifically to the pursuit that you're discussing or trying to create, and sort of all, and all of the things that continue to inspire it. And so once you have that, and that, like I said, that's not necessary to include, but it can help sort of, it can make things more inviting. You know what I mean? So once from there, creating a narrative for your business can sometimes be a little bit trickier.
Hey, Colin, I have a question on that piece. So could you give us an example of, like, you know, when you've been at work and someone kind of reaches out to you, and like, how would that like kind of fit into really kind of, I guess, the ask from them, or like, right? Like how does that like kind of work in a real life situation?
What do you mean?
Like kind of like telling people like your biography, right? It's like,
I guess when you're reaching out to people, it's, I guess I would say it's not as important to give your biography. I guess that sort of comes later when you're either dealing with PR or dealing with customers or dealing with directly with journalists. Like, you don't necessarily have to put in an email when you're like reaching out to anybody details about yourself, but putting, being ready to like give some details about yourself is good to have in mind. Like I wouldn't say in like, if you're writing a press release, it's not necessarily important to give all those background details about yourself, but it's something that you can add in later, especially when people ask about it, and that'll kind of come later. When you use others to tell your story, that's probably the best place to talk about yourself.
Cool.
So,
I have a question on that, Colin.
Yes.
I feel almost like a big piece of how I'm differentiated is because of my background.
Yes.
Like as an herbalist, it's like, I studied pharmacology and I went to like these different schools, or just like having that credibility, I feel like is important to build in. But absolutely. I also have always felt like super uncomfortable being like, look at me, like this is my background.
Be flashy, so. put it out there. There's absolutely include it at the outset. And you know, it's more helpful for people to know that. So there's no reason to feel uncomfortable about saying, because I mean, people would prefer to listen to experts, you know? Mm-hmm. So I would say whenever you can mention why it is that you're credible in your field, there's no problem in doing so.
Okay.
So rule one, toot your own horn, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, shamelessly.
Yeah. You know, one way that we like to do it at the Village is we do like feature Fridays.
Okay.
And so we either feature members within the community or customers, or occasionally you feature the founder. And that's a time to tell about your story and introduce yourself to all the new people who may not know you. And it's a good way that you don't have to sound like you're always talking about yourself.
I think that's a great way. It evens the playing field. Everybody gets an opportunity to talk about themselves in a comfortable environment. Because it's not always comfortable to talk about yourself, you know. Like, but ultimately, at the end of the day, people want to know that stuff. So,
awesome.
Go for it.
I was actually going to say, does anybody else have anything to say?
Well, I have a question here too, is it's like, okay, like kind of thinking about your fingerprint, right? That like, you're the only person with that unique fingerprint, right? So I think like how, do you have any suggestions on really, again, kind of like how you kind of tie like your competitive advantage or your uniqueness into that, like kind of, again, more like expert space, right? Where there's kind of like the balance of like, yes, you're an expert in this field, but like there's a ton of experts in this field, right? But like, how do you make sure that within kind of that you're putting your fingerprint on it, that then really makes like distinguishes you from like, you know, this expert or that expert?
Yeah, I mean, credentials help, but that's the point where you start talking about passion. That's the point where you start talking about why you love what it is that you're doing. Cause that's, I feel like what really separates people. When people can really sense that you are deeply involved and deeply care about what it is you're doing, that's what'll separate them from any list of things that you've achieved, you know? So yeah, absolutely. I'd say the more you can discuss, and then like I said, is what sort of got you into it, some of the biographical information that can help people sort of realize that it was a journey for you to get there, you know? So anybody else, or should I keep running down the line? All good? Cool. But yeah, so once you, I guess, circling back, talking about yourself, you'll find a place to do that, whether it's at the beginning or whether you're talking to media. I'd say, best of all, it's that once people have sort of engaged the conversation is when you can start sort of delving into what you have involved. But you definitely always want to start talking about your business. And one of the best places to start is some historical information, including details about when it opened or will open. And from there, well-articulated vision, and then close with plans for the future. So where you been, where are you at, where are you going? And then sort of when you're using others, or using a story to help others that have the experience, which is probably definitely something you want to include at the outset when you're sending over a pitch. You definitely want to sort of give a vision of why people should care about what it is that you're doing. So when it comes to using storytelling to inspire experiences, this is a place where you could probably have a lot of fun. If you can articulate ahead of time everything that you want folks to take away from the project, that will sort of calibrate them ahead of time to get the most out of the experience. And more than likely, no matter how much your vision shaped their time, they'll walk away with something that augments the original. So they'll have that, and then they'll be able to build on that. So and then this is kind of where I have the most knowledge, is where using others to tell your story. Sort of once you're past the initial pitch, when you're talking to journalists, when you're talking to PR, this is where you can really build your story. And well, telling your story is good. If you really want to get the word out, if you really want to develop something, it's best if you can get other people to tell it as well. So you can deal with PR. PR is good. PR firms can help act as an intermediary between you and journalists. And perhaps if you're an unknown, they can add a certain amount of credibility. If journalists receive stuff from a PR firm, they'll look at it probably with less scrutiny if it's from a PR firm, but that doesn't mean you necessarily need to go through that. And if you can write a good press release, there's a good chance you can avoid using a PR firm. So, because if people get something in their email, looks good, looks professional, it doesn't really matter who it's from. So, but also if you do want to use PR, that can be really helpful if you like having someone to bounce ideas off of that has been around the block a few times. And if at any point during the process, if you need that somebody to help sort of develop your idea, they can be really helpful. And sort of what I was talking about earlier about presenting your story, a good press release kind of has all of that, maybe less of the biographical stuff that can all come later. But if you are writing a press release, always put at the front the date, the time, the cost, and the location. Don't hide that. That has to be right up front. So dealing with journalists. So as a journalist, I'm largely listening to people talk about themselves and their businesses, after which I try and take all that information and put it into something cohesive. I try to look for themes and see what gets people excited, and I take detailed notes in order to tell a story with very real characterization. So I'm trying to figure that out, and a lot of people doing sort of culture media will do the same. They're trying to promote you. This is not like, most of the time it's not investigative journalism. A lot of times if people are reaching out to you, they want to promote what you're doing. And so speaking of that, I like writing stories that uplift my subjects as much as possible. But not everybody is going to do this. Even so, I'd still recommend being as open as you can while kind of feeling out the interaction. If it's clear that someone is trying to dig up dirt or scoffing at your ideas, you have no obligation to offer damning details. You can shut interviews down. But I think largely, like I said, culture, media, and especially since all of you are doing cool stuff, I think mostly people will, if they're trying to write a story about it, it'll be kind of veering towards the promotional. They'll be saying, hey, this is cool. Come do this, you know? And also people will ask their own questions. They'll have their own vision at the outset, or at least they'll have their own ideas that they're coming in to discuss. So if you have certain aspects of your story that aren't coming up naturally during the questioning process, don't be afraid to mention them or steer a conversation back towards your story. I mean, ultimately, they're trying to hear everything that you're putting on the table, and either they don't know what to ask or the conversation can go any number of ways. So it's good to have the confidence at the outset to say, hey, this is something that we didn't get to mention. This is something that I want to include. This is kind of what my story is all about. And so, yeah, more often than not, if you've been cold called by a journalist, they're excited to tell your story. You know, they'll, if they're reaching out to you because you've already developed some kind of buzz, they'll be wanting to talk to you. They'll be excited. And if you or your PR firms have reached out to publications, which you absolutely should do, once you have your idea, once you have something you should do, look up who's doing culture, look up who, anybody who's in the field that you're doing, write them an email. A lot will get back to you, some won't. But send them a press release, say, hey, if you want to talk about what I'm doing, I'd be very interested in discussing with you. And yeah, once you've done that, whoever is responding, they'll more than likely have competed with their peers at the magazine to get the opportunity to speak with you. So once again, they're there, they're excited, they want to talk to you. And so if you've invited journalists out to an experience or project to cover an event, they'll more than likely expect to be comped for it if they've been at it for a while. This isn't required, you don't have to do this at all, but that's something if you should make clear at the outset. And basically between telling your own story and using others, it's a good way not only to bulk up the portrayal with additional perspectives, like the more people you have thinking about the story, the wider the scope is, the more of a real story it is. But it also helps establish clout and mystique. And word of mouth doesn't always happen by accident. So that's it.
Awesome. Thank you. Well, so questions. Does anyone have questions?
What exactly is a, like when you say press release, like what all does that entail exactly?
So like basically,
I send someone a press release.
If you're sending a press release, it says once you have your idea formulated and you're sending it out, sort of telling outlets, or I guess, yeah, press release is for outlets. It's telling outlets to pay attention to what you're doing. It's saying, it's just kind of to put yourself on the media's radar. It's saying, hey, this is what I'm doing. This is when it's happening. And this is why you should be interested. And if you want to come cover it, this is a way that we can kind of organize a discussion.
So it's usually for an event.
Either it can come ahead of the event if you want somebody to come and sort of kind of talk about your ideas with you and sort of develop promotional material ahead of time to say like, hey, this is going to happen and we should talk about this event in the future. Or if it's an event is happening, that can largely be easier to cover. You can invite the media down to report on your event that is happening and they'll report that has happened. And generally that's if you're gonna have repeat events, you know, so people can come in and be like, all right, this is what happened and it's gonna happen again next week, you know?
Got it, okay.
But the event, the launch of a business, right?
Yeah, the launch of a business even more so, because then it'll happen every week that follows, you know?
One thing I'll add from a marketing perspective, we always tell our clients, I also have a marketing firm, so it's not at the Village, but we always say, when you're pitching to media outlets, always pitch how their audience will benefit from your knowledge or how their audience will benefit from your event.
100%.
Everything is about their audience. And then they look at it and go, oh, I have something of value to write about or to talk about or.
Exactly. Exactly. And I guess that's just speaking to that, it's good to have some sense of when you're reaching out to people who their audience might be. And you can only gather that so much, but yeah. Do a little homework and real and with each group that you're reaching out to, make sure that it's the audience that you're trying to reach.
I have a question. Oh, go ahead.
Nope, you can go ahead.
Okay. I'm wondering, so as someone who's been in the arts and has, you know, created events and shows and things on an ongoing basis.
Yes.
How often, I mean, I've sent out press releases for large projects, but like how often, if you have something that's ongoing, that's always changing, that's always doing events, how often are you supposed to reach out to the media about those things to create like the ongoing involvement?
I mean, really, really as much as you want, as much as you feel comfortable. I mean, the worst thing somebody can do if you send a press release is leave it in their inbox, you know, like, so anything that you think you would want covered, send it out. I don't think there's any amount that's too much. You're not going to get annoying to people, you know?
Okay. Great.
So.
Colin, can you talk on like social media? Is it good to connect with these people on social to just kind of share their content or?
I mean, generally, yes. I mean, I know that journalists appreciate their stories being shared on your social just as a way to kind of connect and spread the word. But that it's not, you don't have to do anything enormous. It's good to share stories, and that's kind of what it is. But you only should share the story that's kind of pertaining to what you're involved in.
Colin, on that point. On that point, I wonder if you could speak to, you know, with some publications or outlets, they'll have a specific digital or social team that does their own separate coverage in addition to the journalists and the print reporters.
Reach out to everybody. Sometimes I know definitely in my case, I do not communicate with the social team all that much. So it's best if you have all of your bases covered, because there's no guarantee that the journalist is going to be well connected with social. Sorry, my dog in the background is starting to make noise.
Listening. How much do people usually want to be comped for? What's a typical range, I guess, for writing different articles?
What do you mean?
So you had mentioned that they would want to get
being comfortably experienced. They just want to come and do whatever it is that you're doing for free. I mean,
comped. Okay, not like. Paid?
Not paid. Just they just want to come and not pay the ticket price.
I get it. Okay. Thank you.
No, there's no cash handouts or anything.
Okay.
Colin, would that be a red flag if a reporter's asking to be paid?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I guess there's some publications that do it, and then that gets into like, that's essentially advertising at that point. And if somebody's asking you for money, there's going to be 10 other people who are not. Don't fall into that trap. And generally, if they're going to be asking to get paid at the outset without explicitly being advertising, they're probably not doing good journalism.
Okay.
So Colin, I have a marketing background, and a lot of times I've interacted with clients or organizations that I help, and they sort of have unrealistic expectations of, getting a placement, you know, on the front page of the Denver Post or in Nine News. And I wondered if you could kind of speak to, you know, kind of understanding the breadth of what, you know, you have to cover and your responsibilities, and just, you know, having realistic expectations about, you know, where you might be able to get the best placement or the best coverage?
So, I mean, I guess reach out to as many people as possible and figure out where your story is most relevant, what kind of media it fits most in. Like, and, you know, I'm not really sure. I think a lot of the culture publications in town have sort of an even set up. Not a lot of people are doing front page. A lot of people are doing digital. And a lot of times, if you're a new business, what you can expect is to be somewhere in the magazine. You know, it's there's no way, unless you're doing anything real crazy, that you're going to be front page news straight out of the gates.
Just have a question. I'm curious if reaching out by phone is more effective than just emailing an email address from the website.
I would say always start with email. Cold calling is generally kind of unexpected. And I mean, you can cold call an editor, maybe. I wouldn't cold call individual writers. I would say email is probably the best way to kind of
kind of
keep it easy.
Cool, thanks.
Kind of on a related point, what does the timing look like? If you get the press release like 2 months before the event, is that like too far in the future, or, you know, is 2 weeks like too short an amount of time?
You know, it depends on the scope. I think the more time that you give people, the better. But then I would say actually do both. Do the 2 months and then the 2 week. You know, unless you're like, if you do the 2 month and you aren't like actively going back and forth with whoever it is that is planning on writing for you, come back with a 2 week, and then sort of the more the merrier with that. And you know, sometimes, and it's good to get, if you have an idea in place and you have an event, people, it's good for people to get it on their calendars as far ahead of time as possible.
Colin, this is Laura. I was wondering what your experience has been with using influencers, if you have any, and how important you feel those are in at least in the Denver market.
I mean, it's just another sort of way to solve the same problem, you know? I mean, traditional media is doing more straightforward journalism, writing, and then going through sort of established channels to do it. And influencers are going to get a different market. They're doing less writing. They're doing Instagram posts. And honestly, a lot of the times those influencer posts catch a lot of attention. So sort of finding a balance between the two, it can be good. Using influencers can be good because they're approaching the same thing from just a different angle. And the more angles that you have, the better.
Well, so what I was thinking is when I do an initial dinner,
yes,
the importance of the 8 people sitting at that table being people that can communicate their experience into, you know, so what would be your vision from your perspective of the most important either media or other that should sit at that table?
I would say, I guess if there's only 8 seats at the table, I would only reserve 1 or maybe 2 for either 2 members of the media or a media and an influencer. But it kind of, I don't know, that's a hard one because that's a small table. I would actually say in that case, it might be interesting to invite media and influencers in ahead of time to sort of have a pre-experience that they could all describe since it's so tight.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, is that if I did an initial one that kind of then kind of pre-party yeah, before the launch, so that people could see.
I mean, previews are a pretty standard thing, where it's exclusively for media, and just a time where you can come and you have a seat at the table and you can talk a great deal about what you're doing and sort of walk people through the experience so they can in turn walk their audience through the experience.
Is there a list anywhere of like local publications. I think of like 5280 and Westword, Denver Post, and that's all. But just like immediately that comes to mind.
Let's not forget 303 Magazine.
Oh my goodness. Yes, obviously.
I mean, you can look up local publications. I can send some stuff over.
Okay.
If you want to send your email, I can shoot over some of the mm-hmm. key. I mean, those are the most key players, and then from there, there's a few offshoots. So.
Okay.
Yeah. Start with that.
I have another question too, kind of thinking about like your own like owned media, right? Of like your social channels, your newsletters, like blogs, all of that. Like maybe could you like speak to kind of thinking about how you could work with journalists to create like your own content, right? That then kind of becomes like your own, like part of your own storytelling, right? Like what are some of like maybe like pros or cons, right? To kind of thinking about how you can work with like writers to then create your own content that then starts to tell your story.
Are you talking about bringing writers in to ahead of time to do your stuff?
Yeah, like maybe like blog posts. So I'm just kind of thinking it's like, this is like my own personal thing. So it's like, you know, kind of just doing the things that you're good at and then like thinking about like, you know, where on the things that maybe you're not as good at, like finding the help. So it's like, you know, kind of thinking like, say, I want to create some blog posts, but I want the content to be like really awesome. Just like maybe tips and tricks around like how you could maybe hire journalists or writers to help you develop out that content.
So if you want to spend an arm and a leg on that same thing, hire a PR firm. If you want to do it for cheap, reach out to journalists or reach. I guess it's kind of a tricky thing because it's you kind of have to have some rapport with people before you as a journalist before you just cold call them to write in-home content. But if you know anybody or if anybody has written a story for you, I guarantee they'd be down to follow up and write stuff for much, much cheaper than PR firms would. You know, a lot of journalists are hungry and trying to get their name out in any kind of way possible. But yeah, I wouldn't ask any member of the media at face to write stuff just for you, you know? So.
So don't cold call them for that.
Yeah.
How about this too? Like, you know, because it's like, I love this because these are kind of like fun bookends. You know, we started the Accelerator program with really just like, you know, understanding like the story of your experience, right? Yeah. And kind of thinking, I guess, right, that would be like more fiction, right? The like non-true one, right? I always get those backwards. Yeah, fiction. And then what we're talking about here is really like the more non-fiction, which is really, you know, once you've kind of developed out like the story of your experience, like then how do you start to kind of like package that with like non-fiction types of like storytelling? So, you know, like, I guess, do you have like kind of thinking about the transfer from like really kind of the fiction piece and the fantasy of the experience into the nonfiction kind of more like nuts and bolts kind of storytelling? Do you have like any kind of thoughts around that?
I mean, that's the thing is the best kind of storytelling involves both. It gets all of the details. It gets the concrete stuff there as clearly as possible. Like if that's the foundation, you need all of the nonfiction elements there. They need to be clear. Like that people need to know what they're dealing with in the concrete. And then from there, there's a lot of room to fictionalize. There's a lot of room to sort of add heart and considerations for what you want it to be. And that's sort of where it starts to get into the fiction. Because like your vision can be as sort of magical or inspiring as you have the scope in your own mind. So I think it's absolutely important to begin with the nuts and bolts, to begin with the concrete, and from there do whatever, you know, like go go crazy, because it's absolutely important to include those nonfiction elements, because if it's just not nuts and bolts, it's going to be dull. And if it's no nuts and bolts, it's strictly in the clouds, that's not going to attract people either. That's, you know, you need both.
Well, I guess, like, I don't know. I think that's, like, again, when you're the creator of something, right? I think maybe personal, but just like kind of thinking like creativity is so personal, right? That it like, it makes you just kind of have to be very vulnerable, right? To be able to like tell other people about like what your ideas are and what your thoughts are and like where it came from and all of that other stuff. But I don't know, from what I'm hearing, it's just kind of like the more you do that, like the more of the benefit there is, right?
And no, it requires huge vulnerability, and that's kind of where the bravery comes in. You have to be open, and that's scary, and you just kind of got to trudge through it.
Everyone's always like, "You want to do what?" Like, yeah, I want to do that. Any other questions? No? All right. Well, I guess, you know, kind of just use a few housekeeping things, but let's give another huge round of applause for Colin. Thank you, Colin, so much for, there we got my little emoji claps there. thank you so much for sharing your time with us today and all of that good knowledge and all of that. And do you mind if I share your address with email with everyone?
Please. Yeah. If anybody has any follow-up questions, please reach out. Happy to answer. So,
cool. Awesome.
Thank you.
Cool. So, okay. So now, speaking of communications and just, you know, kind of next steps in the program. So, Dawn, we're going to need to get kind of just like the assets for like, you know, logos and all of that, that we're going to, you know, for promotion and just to really kind of recognize Centennial as really kind of the sponsor of this program and all of that kind of like good stuff from you. So if you can send that to me, or actually if you want to post that in the Slack, that would even be better. Cut me out as the middleman. That's even better. Okay, so Dawn's going to go ahead and put that in the Slack. Now, the next piece is that it looks like we're going to work with Rainbow Dome to help make a really fun poster for our cohort, our 2021 cohort. So to help with really kind of making this the most awesome poster ever, if everyone could maybe just send me like a one sentence description of your concept that you're going to be executing on, that would really make my life really awesome. And also the name of the project or the experience as well. So I'll put this information in Slack as well. So we make a little template so we can start collecting that. And then also the dates, and then also just like the cost of the experience. So we will go ahead and put all of that together. And then we'll work with Rainbow Dome to make a super fun poster. And then the next Spark Accelerator session that we're going to have next month, we're going to then go ahead and kind of do a fun little reveal of the assets that were created and kind of just go over like ideas around usage, how we can work together to, again, just really tap into all of our own networks to start promoting like what everyone is doing. And then also have a fun little Q&A with Frankie and Theron on just like, you know, kind of reasoning for how these assets were created and just to really kind of get the backstory on all of it. So
Can I interrupt you really quick, Brian?
No.
Already have. Just so that we, not that it will all get used visually, but like the more, if you have logos, the title of your business, the title of the event, just like the more information you send, if you're doing like a special product or promotion or something, that all that could help potentially with whatever happens.
Yes.
Cool. I love that. And do you have any preferred like delivery methods?
Actually, Slack is probably easiest for us if everyone's sending us information. I mean, files, JPEGs are fine. It doesn't need to be anything fancy.
And we can follow up individually if we need something in a different format.
Yeah.
Cool. I love that. Sweet. And then anything else? Does anyone have any questions or anything so far?
I was just wondering what the timeline is for those things, getting that stuff to you guys.
I would say as soon as possible. Our next meeting is what, a month away?
Yeah.
So I think we'd like to have the flyer designed before then, or at least mostly designed. So maybe within a week would be really good.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, I think we could be a little flexible too on when we have our next session, just, you know, to kind of, because I do think it would be probably to our advantage to have it done. So then we can really kind of like, you know, really talk about how we share these and all of that. So
totally. And we can also like change some things about it, you know.
Right. Mm-hmm. It can be edited.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And then, you know, a lot of, I think through the meetings that I had with everyone individually is that, you know, there's a lot of collaboration and just like overlap and doing more things together that wants to happen. And so I say, everyone has the email addresses of the other people. So if you just want to start kind of reaching out to each other, or of course, like Slack, you can do it on Slack, but I just say, go ahead and start making that magic happen. And then Dawn, it seems that everyone, you know, kind of tentatively has said that September 18th seems like a good day for kind of having that like launch, like Spark launch. So anyway, you know, I think, you'll probably be getting some emails as well, just on some of the details of that.
Awesome, that sounds great. Yeah, if I could just, you know, get an idea of what people are thinking, how they'd like to have a presence at our 20-year anniversary at the Streets of South Glen, which is the event in September, that would be fantastic.
Cool. Any other?
Don, we would really like to schedule a time to come visit the space so we can see how skatable certain parts. Oh, yeah.
And then you can swing by and have tea at my house.
Perfect.
That's great. I'm like 3 blocks away.
Perfect.
Awesome. So is Dawn bringing skates?
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was just saying is what I'm hearing, Dawn, is that you need to bring your roller skates too.
That would be awesome. Yeah, maybe we can connect and you know, just talk more about. I'm happy to meet you at South Glen and kind of figure out what area would work best for what you're wanting to do. And, you know, I'll bring Candace, who's kind of really leading the whole event, along so that she can kind of give guidance about, well, we've got this space reserved for this and whatnot. So
great.
Great.
Cool. Anything else? Awesome. Well, everyone knows where to find me. So if you have any questions or anything, just go ahead and reach out to me. And other than that, I guess, yeah, just I'll be following up to you with everyone just to kind of start working out the details on really how we start making all this stuff happen and just like how we get the funding to you and all of that other stuff. So yeah, but other than that, I guess we're done here. And happy Friday, everyone. Thanks for joining. And again, thanks to Colin for sharing all of his expertise and all of his good ideas. And yeah, thanks again to everyone for participating. And we'll be in touch.
And thank you for listening. I really appreciate it. I hope it proves helpful. So
thanks.
Awesome. See you guys.
Bye.
Bye.